This is a Microbit V2, and it will be our introduction to embedded systems programming with Rust. The Microbit is a system on a chip, which is in contrast to the kind of computer you could build with, you know, one of those shiny new Ryzen chips with an NVIDIA GPU. The latter example is pieced together from discrete parts. You choose a CPU, a GPU, a set of RAM, some storage, Ethernet ports, etc. A system on a chip is entirely contained in a single package. And while you may have built a mini ITX computer with discrete parts, which can be pretty small, microcontrollers can be smaller than your credit card. And you don't have to deal with any of that, you know, 600 watt power draw from your GPU. Typically, embedded systems are used to control physical processes, like controlling the temperature in a building. A microcontroller can use temperature sensors to read in data and use that data to drive actuators, which can say, turn on the air conditioning. I set up my Microbit development environment on an M1 Mac, but there are instructions for more platforms in the Discovery Embedded Rust ebook, so be sure to check that out if you're running on Windows or Linux. I had a bit of trouble getting GDB appropriately installed for later, so if you're on an M1 Mac and have trouble like I did, make sure you snag the information from Ferris Systems Embedded Trainings, which worked for me. The Microbit V2 features we're going to use are the USB port, the LED matrix on the back, and the microcontroller itself. Many elements on the Microbit are labeled right on the board, which is really nice if you're not used to reading electronics. We're here to blink some LEDs though, so with that introduction out of the way, let's get started building programs and uploading them to the board. So we've got ourselves a Microbit and we need to flash some programs onto it. We are going to be following the LED roulette section of the Discovery ebook for the Rust Embedded Discovery series, or whatever you want to call it. So we've got the repo cloned here, which has a whole bunch of code in it. Inside of the Microbit folder, inside of source, there is a number 5 that has a main.rs. And here we can see the complete program that we're going to build and flash to our board. Now, there's a number of things to be interested in this code. I would say that the first two are no main and no standard. Because this is an embedded system, because this is a system on a chip, we are going to not have the standard library that Rust defines available to us. So we use the no standard attribute macro to be like, hey, we're not using the standard library. The second attribute macro that we really care about is no main. We don't actually emit a main symbol from our program. You'll note that down below, this function is still called main, but this main function and the main symbol emitted from the compilation process are not going to be the same thing. So this function is actually nameable, theoretically, whatever we want to. That said, we are bringing in something that will define a main for us, and that's this Cortex M RT crates entry macro. We also bring in Panicalt and Microbit, which we don't really care about right now. I think the other really interesting piece that is different from a regular Rust program is that we aren't returning unit here from main. We're returning exclamation point. This exclamation point means that our program never terminates. So we'll never return from this function once we run it. You can imagine how normally in like a CLI application, that would be not what you want. But in this case, we have stuck a little loop in the back here just so that our program keeps running forever. And you can see a little bit of code on lines 11, 12, and 13. That is just kind of like arbitrary code. To get this to actually compile, we have to go into this embed.toml file and uncomment the chipset that we're using. So for my example, I'm going to use the NRF52833_XXAA, which is the line for the Microbit V2. We've also set a couple of configurations here. First, we want to halt the chip after we've flashed the program so that our program doesn't immediately start and get into the infinite loop. We're going to disable RTT. This is a debug protocol. We don't need to send text back from our program to a debugger right now, so we're just going to turn it off. But we are going to turn on GDB support. And this GDB support is required for us to be able to connect to our application using GDB. The Microbit V2 requires that we have a specific target available to compile to. That is this target specifically. So I've already added it, and you can see that I'm in the root of the repo right now. I'm going to go into Microbit, into source, into 5LEDRoulette, which is the project that we're working with at the moment. And I'm going to cargo build with features V2, target, and then the target that we just installed. Now this repo is built as a learning source, so the features V2 is really just to enable the V2 series of library code rather than the V1 microbit series of code to verify that we actually produced a binary that is an ARM binary because the microbit board is an ARM chip. We can use this fairly long cargo command. So we're going to cargo read object, again with features V2, because we're using the V2 when we compile our application. We're going to target the platform that is responsible for existing on the microbit V2, the one that we just installed. We're going to specify the bin LED roulette, which is the binary that we have right here. And then we're going to use a double dash before the flag for file headers. So if we run this and I scroll up a little bit, we can see a variety of information about the binary that we created. In this case, we can see that the machine that we're targeting is in fact an ARM machine. So to actually get this onto the board, we're going to use something that's slightly different called cargo embed. So I have my chip connected right now via a USB port to my computer. So if I run cargo embed with the features that we're using and the target platform, so the microbit V2, if it fails for you and it fails in something like failed attaching to target, the connected chip could not be automatically be determined. Make sure that you've saved this embed.toml change. So now if we run the same command, we see erasing sectors. So we're erasing the place that we're putting the program. We're flashing it to the board, and then it stops and waits for GDB to connect because we specified that it should in the embed.toml. At this point, cargo embed is kind of holding a place for our program to start running. So we want to attach GDB to the program and then have it start running. So for me, because I used the Ferris Systems method of installing GDB, I have a binary called armnun-eabi-gdb in my path. Your path might just be GDB depending on the system you're on, but I'm going to point this to the binary inside of the target directory. This is from the root of the project. So I'm in the root of the project here. That is the microbit folder. I'm going to look at target. I'm going to look for the target platform, which is the microbit target platform, inside of debug because I built it as debug, and then look for the LED roulette binary and use that as the path to this ARM GDB. You'll get this wonderful page of whatever it is. Just hit enter and GDB will start. Now we need to tell it where to connect to our actual board. So if you look above, we're on effectively localhost 1337. So if we target remote 1337 with a colon on the front, we end up connecting to the GDB stub, which gives us the location in our program that we are currently at. Now we want to get into main so we can set up a breakpoint in main by typing break main. It'll give us some feedback about whether it was successful or not. And then we can type continue, which will run our program until hitting the main function. Now there's a whole bunch of stuff that you can do with GDB, but I'm just going to run continue and then our function will just keep running. So I can close this down just like we started it. I like using control D to exit, but you can also just type quit and it will tell you that the GDB session is going to detach from the process that we attached it to. And I'll kill the GDB stub as well. Back in main.rs, we can replace the code that we had with some new code. This is the code that will actually light up one of the LEDs on the LED grid on the microbit. We do bring in some new code, so microbit how prelude star. Specifically, we are bringing in the output pin trait, which will give us this set low and set high function. This is how we're going to communicate with the LEDs to turn them on and off. And secondly, we'll import board from microbit, which allows us to actually, you know, work with the microbit board itself. In the same way that we use kind of exclusive references and ownership in Rust to represent things that we need exclusive access to or we can share, this board take is actually here so that we can only take this once, because taking control of peripherals and representing that with two different variables could lead to confusing and problematic behavior because we'd still be modifying the same physical resource. Now the LEDs on the board are set up in a 5x5 grid. And then we do something here where we take the display pins on the board. So the pins that represent the LEDs, we set column one to low and we set row one to high. We'll use the exact same commands to get this running. So we use cargo embed to build and flash it. The GDB stub is listening. And then we use the ARM GDB to get us into GDB. Remember, we need to target the remote port on 1337. So we do that. And then GDB is connected and running, and we have connected to our application. If I just type continue here because the program has stopped, because that's the setting that we have in embed.toml, then we'll see the light in the first column and the first row turn on. So that's the top left light, top left LED. Now moving on into the next segment, we'll bring in some timers from the Microbit HAL module, and then we'll also bring in an alternate panic implementation. So we're going to bring in the RTT init print macro, which will set up the RTT for us, and the panic halt becomes panic RTT target. Rust only allows us to use one panic implementation at a given time, so that's why we have to, you know, only have one here. Other than that, the code is fairly easy to understand. We create a new timer using board timer 0. This is a timer that exists inside of our board. And inside of our loop at the bottom, we're going to use that timer on the board to delay for 1,000 milliseconds. This is 1,000 as a U16. And then we'll use the RTT to print back 1,000 milliseconds passed. Now, because we're going to use the RTT to pass messages back, we have to make some changes. In this case, we're going to change halt afterwards to false because we don't really want to connect GDB to have to, you know, continually run our program. We're going to change the RTT enabled to true because we're using it now, and we're going to change GDB to false. Now, when we go to build this program, you may run into this problem right here, which says that import resolution is stuck. Try simplifying macro imports. Specifically, it can't resolve our print line. And if we scroll up, because the most relevant error often is not at the bottom, we can see a number of unable to determines, unresolved imports, but specifically the one that we care about is undeclared crater module RTT target. If we look at the cargo TOML, we can see that these crates are already set up for us, but we do have to uncomment them for them to actually be available to our program. So if we do that and we rebuild, then we see this terminal pop up and we get that RTT output back and printed to our console. So we're seeing here 1,000 milliseconds passed every 1,000 milliseconds. And you can control C to stop it. We can combine the delay technique that we just discovered with the LED technique that we took knowledge of previously. In this case, we take the board, we create the timer, we get the display pins for column one and we set them to low, and then we get a mutable reference to row one, which is the first difference from our other LED code. In this case, we set row one to low at the beginning of our loop. We print dark, so we'll see dark in the console. We'll set a delay of 1,000 milliseconds, so you can put underscores inside of numbers in Rust. It's not a problem. This is 1,000 as a U16. Then we set row one to high, which will blink the light on. We print out light, which we'll see to the console. And then we delay again, and this is a loop, so it'll set it back to low. And then set it to high, then set it to low, then set it to high. So if we run this new code, it'll compile. It'll go dark, light, dark, light, dark, light, every about 1,000 milliseconds. And now you have a blinking LED on your Microbit V2.